From our galaxy, we move outward into the further blackness of space. Compared to the distance between galaxies, the distance between the stars seems small by comparison. We quickly move into the realm of hundreds of thousands of light years. Remember, it takes hundreds of thousands of years for the light from the closest galaxies to reach us. If you were on a planet about 100 light years away from the Earth, you would be detecting Earth's first radio broadcasts. From your point of view, it would be the early 1900s on Earth. You would be able to hear in real time the outbreak of World War I. The Milky Way is a number of satellite galaxies ranging from 42,000 light years for the Canis Major dwarf galaxy to over 820,000 light years for Leo 1. The Large Magellanic Cloud orbits the Milky Way at about 180,000 light years away. Many diffuse nebula, planetary nebula, and other spectacular astronomical features have been observed in the LMC. It is close enough for our most powerful telescopes to resolve many of its features. If any doubt lingers as to the distances ascribed to the local group of galaxies, it turns out that those doubts were put to rest by an amazing discovery made in 1987. That year, a supernova designated SN1987A was observed in the LMC. This star had a large circumstellar dust ring surrounding it. At the time, we saw the light from the supernova explosion before we saw it reflected off the dust ring. Astronomers using the International Ultraviolet Explorer were able to measure the time it took the light from the explosion to reach the ring to be 0.66 years. The diameter of the dust ring was then calculated to be 1.32 light years. More importantly, by comparing the angular and true sizes, we find the distance to SN1987A, and thus to this region of the Large Magellanic Cloud, to be about 168,000 light years. This permitted astronomers also to calibrate the luminosity of the Cepheid variable stars in the LMC. Then, knowing how bright Cepheids are, we can measure the distances to many other galaxies. Because of the fixed speed of light, we were able to directly and accurately measure the distance to this supernova by using triangulation, all due to a star that exploded about 168,000 years ago. The Andromeda Galaxy is our nearest large neighbor galaxy. It and the Milky Way, together with a few others, form the local group of galaxies. Before modern-day telescopes, Andromeda was classified as a nebula and thought to be within 17,000 light years. We now know that Andromeda is a galaxy, and that it lies much farther from Earth. Andromeda and the Milky Way are approaching each other at about 100 kilometers a second, but due to the great distance between them, the eventual collision will not happen soon, as the Andromeda Galaxy lies more than 2.5 million light years away. As was mentioned, the Milky Way has a diameter of roughly 100,000 light years. This means that if it was traveling at the speed of light, which it can't, but that's the maximum speed anything can travel at, it would take it 100,000 years to move one diameter width through space. At their current speed, it will take billions of years for this collision to take place. The Andromeda Galaxy is actually closer than it appears, because we see it as it was 2.5 million years ago. Its light traveled the void of space at the fixed speed of 299,792 kilometers a second before reaching us. In the meantime, it's moved closer to us. 28 million years ago, the light we see from the Sombrero Galaxy began its long journey across space, finally reaching the lenses of our telescopes today. We can only speculate on what will happen during the collision of Andromeda and the Milky Way, but that dance is already being played out 45 million light years away. The antenna galaxies are in the midst of a massive collision and merger. The antenna galaxies appear static. During your whole life, they will appear exactly the same, but they are moving. As was previously mentioned, it takes a colossal amount of time for this process to play out. What we see is a snapshot in time, and it will take many millions of years, perhaps billions, for them to completely merge into one galaxy. NGC 5866, also known as the Spindle Galaxy, is a disk galaxy 44 million light years away that is tilted nearly edge-on to our line of sight, allowing us a clear view of the dust lanes silhouetted by the bright glow of the galactic core. Another relatively close galaxy, providing us with a spectacular view, is Flocculent Spiral Galaxy NGC 4414, at 62 million light years distant. We speak of these galaxies as being relatively close to us, because on the scale of the known universe, they are indeed right in our backyard. Galaxy NGC 1300 is about 69 million light years away from us, yet it is close enough for us to image it in great detail. However, when you zoom into this Hubble image, you see that behind it are dozens of much further galaxies. They are so far away that all we can see of them are faint, grainy smudges showing galactic cores and spiral arms. We see NGC 1300 as it was 69 million years ago, but how much farther back in time do we see when we look at these more distant galaxies? How many stars are in each galaxy? How many planets? They are so far away that we will probably never know. 2.2 billion light-years away lies galaxy cluster Abel 1689. This group of galaxies is so massive that it distorts and bends light from the galaxies far behind it, causing a zoom lens effect, known as gravitational lensing. Background galaxies appear as long arcs encircling the central mass of the cluster. Galaxy cluster Abel 2218 lies about 2 billion light-years from us. Its enormous gravitational field deflects light rays passing through it to create this massive zoom lens effect, magnifying the galaxies behind it. The arc-shaped patterns found in this image are the distorted images of galaxies that are at least 5 times farther away than the lensing cluster. This effect graphically illustrates to us the fact that light traveled millions and even billions of years and was acted upon by colossal gravitational forces during its journey. From September 2003 to January 2004, the Hubble telescope was pointed at a black area of space about 1/10 the size of the full moon, with about 1 million seconds of viewing time at the rate of about 1 photon per minute for the most distant objects. A picture gradually appeared of over 10,000 galaxies. This was the deepest view of the universe ever made. Out of this dark patch of sky, seemingly empty and void of light, emerged one of the most astounding and important astronomical discoveries of all time. It is estimated that the number of stars in a galaxy varies from some tens of millions of stars for dwarf galaxies to hundreds of millions of stars, the Milky Way, to 1900 trillion stars in some giant elliptical galaxies. The whole sky contains 12.7 million times more area than this picture. When we zoom in to individual galaxies in the Hubble Ultra Deep Field, we see amazing views of individual galaxies billions of light years away. These galaxies existed in this state billions of years ago. Many of these galaxies appear chaotic and strange in their appearance, a sharp contrast to the classic spiral and elliptical galaxies we see closer to us. For millions and billions of years, light has been weaving through the universe, photon by photon, in never-ending waves, snaking its way past galaxy clusters, through nebula, and straight through the black void of space, and ending up on the sensors of our best scientific instruments. In the last handful of years, we've witnessed the unfolding of an amazing story, one that has unfolded above us, stretching back through countless aeons, and by using our sight and technology, we've become the first time travelers in the history of humanity. The stars are a cosmological clock, running on a timescale that is orders of magnitudes greater than the human lifespan. In our whole lives, the stars will be exactly the same from when we were born to when we die, but they move. To us, they move slowly, but on their timescale, they swirl like water in a drain. They burn up and explode and come together from raw materials and ignite. They are like living things, and the best thing about them is that we can see it all happening. But the creationist will argue with all this. He will claim that God stretched out the heavens and somehow managed to do all of this within a 6,000-year constraint. Okay, so let me get this straight. Everything in the universe was compressed into a very small, dense space, all the billions of galaxies and dark matter all squished up under an unthinkable force of gravity, and then God had this mass explode and inflate into the universe we have now. Okay, so you call it God, and everyone else calls it the Big Bang. So far, so good. But then it gets weird. They want us to believe that God then magically teleported the light from these stars instantly to Earth, so we wouldn't have to wait billions of years for it all to get here. In doing so, he made it look like the light traveled for millions and billions of years. All the events we see out past 6,000 light years didn't actually happen. They're just like a movie God made to make it look like the universe is billions of years old. That's stupid. Can you not see how convoluted that is? Some would want us to believe that instead of that story, all of these events did actually happen, but before God stretched out the heavens, so all of these events happened inside a 6,000 light year bubble, and then God stretched them all out. How do you fit billions of galaxies, each tens of and hundreds of light years across themselves, into a 6,000 light year bubble? How do you do that even with our own galaxy? This nonsensical idea can only exist within the mind of one who is absolutely and completely ignorant of all things cosmological, whose worldview is entirely inward. As Hitchens would say, take heart, the whole universe was created with you in mind. For most of human history, we thought that the stars were static and unchangeable. It was heresy to believe otherwise. God had created it that way. This is almost like the argument for kinds within young Earth creationism. God created it all, just like this. To quote Anatole France, the appearance of a new star to the mysterious personages whom the Gospels call wise men of the East, I assume the incident to be authentic historically, was undoubtedly a miracle to the astrologers of the Middle Ages, who believed that the firmament, in which the stars were stuck like nails, was subject to no change whatever. But whether real or supposed, the Star of the Magi has lost its miraculous character for us, who know that the heavens are incessantly perturbed by the birth and death of worlds, and who in 1866 saw a star suddenly blaze forth in the Corona Borealis, shine for a month, and then go out. It did not proclaim the Messiah. All it announced was that, at an infinitely remote distance from our Earth, an appalling conflagration was burning up a world in a few days. Or rather, had burnt it up long ago, for the ray that brought us the news of this disaster in the heavens had been on the road for 500 years, and possibly longer. End quote. As the heresy of the changing heavens was eventually accepted and incorporated into all belief systems, so eventually evolution will be accepted as well. It's almost the same as we see in the field of genetics, where common ancestry has been proven, but this fact is rejected in favor of the ridiculous notion that God made it look like we evolved from apes over millions of years for what? Look, either the universe is billions of years old, as simple observation indicates, or, if I grant the creationist convoluted idea that their God made it look that way, we come back to the question. If a God made the universe to look billions of years old, how can you blame anyone for believing it?